Besides Homer, Ovid is the best poet to come out of ancient Greece and Rome. Sure, you could argue that Virgil is an excellent poet, too, but I'm not sure Virgil had an understanding of mythos of the Near East like Homer and Ovid did. But maybe I'm wrong, but whether you like Ovid or not personally, you have to respect and even admire the genius of his work. And I would like to go even further out and venture to try and reimagine and reinterpret his Metamorphoses in an effort to better understand him, but more specifically that of the Orphic tradition of the poet and singer Orpheus, and that of the Eleusinian mysteries that I argue come out of the Minoan civilization of Crete, going back as far as the 3rd millennium BC, where the Eleusinian mystery cults are a late Bronze Age and or a Mycenaean adaptation of older mystery cults of the Near East, like Babylon, Assyria, Sumer, Egypt, Akkad, and even the Minoan Crete. So to start the analysis, we want to take a large scope to understand the generalities and formulaic tendencies of an author or mythos to find these symmetries as a better way to interpret the labyrinth of minor and subordinate symbologies, characters, and plots. One might ask, why do you do this? Well, the motivation to embark on these analyses is always to synthesize and create a more robust and overall eugenic ideology for our people. And you do that through religion, science, mathematics, and eventually you want that to culminate into something real, like politics. And each of these larger structures can be broken down into subordinate ones, like religions can inspire poetry, art, music, astronomy, but also serve as mechanisms for increasing the fertility of a selected group of people. And that's probably its most useful function in which it can equip itself with. Eugenically selected symbols, mythos, and music to attract suitable males and females. And I think that's where we are now, right? I don't think the problem with growing an Apollonian cult is too little males or too little of interest from males. It's not enough females, and the lack of spirituality and sensuality and sex and romantic relationships today would probably be the biggest hindrance from us, just from the propaganda standpoint. In reading Book 10 of Ovid's Metamorphoses, one of the most prevalent morals is that if you forget to worship the daughters of Jove, like Venus and Persephone and Diana, women go barren, like Demeter leaves Olympus in rage. The earth doesn't produce wheat, corn, or other staples of both humans and animals for them to nourish themselves for the winter ahead. It's essentially the story of the Eleusinian mysteries, the abduction and rape of Persephone by Pluto, and subsequent rage of Demeter. And in Book 10 of Ovid's Metamorphoses, it's told through the tradition of Orpheus and the loss of his wife Eurydice, in addition to other tales like that most famously of Adonis, who both Venus and Persephone are infatuated with. But bottom line, if you forget to worship Venus, Persephone, they'll curse you and fall for others, and you'll be subjected to barren and stubborn rage of Demeter. Moreover, we can relate the Iliad and Exodus to the Orphic tradition, given in Ovid's Metamorphoses, and ultimately link it or understand it as Eleusinian mystery, the precursor to Judaism and Christianity. I argue you can read the Iliad through the story of Demeter, too. So whether you read the Homeric hymn to Demeter or the Orphic tradition written in the Metamorphoses of Ovid, you're talking about the Eleusinian mystery cults and ultimately the same Near East mythology that comes out of Egypt and even Minoan Greece. For this video's purpose, I think three texts is more than plenty to analyze. So, to put it in stone, we can compare the Iliad, Exodus, and more in particular, Book 10 of Ovid's Metamorphoses. But if you wanted to read the Homeric hymn to Demeter, it's much the same, where we can understand Achilles as like Demeter, and he turns to a stubborn rage, withdrawing from the war and taking his myrmidons with him, much like Demeter withdraws from Olympus and the world goes barren when Persephone is taken from her by Pluto. Right, so we can understand the beginning of the Iliad in the same way, where Agamemnon, a Pluto-like figure, takes Briseis from Achilles, the girl he loves. And moreover, we can understand Achilles as Orpheus, who has his wife-to-be, Eurydice, taken from him as well. So after Eurydice's bitten by a snake on their wedding day, Orpheus then tries to rescue her from Hades and Pluto, But when she's escaping with Eurydice, he looks back and she vanishes back to Hades, thus ending all hopes for Orpheus at his true love. So he resigns back to home to try and find a new love. And this is where we find Achilles in Book 9, right? About to sail back to Athia and home, away from the Trojan War without Briseis, but still a rich man who will find a nice wife back home in Greece. There we find him playing on the lyre, where we can imagine him as Orpheus, and Achilles is playing the lyre as this royal envoy led by Odysseus approaches the camp in an effort to persuade Achilles back into the fight, right? And this is how we find him in Book 9 of the Iliad. And Odysseus comes with vast promises of wealth and prizes from Agamemnon, along with one of his daughters in marriage. And Achilles then rejects the offer to come back and fight for Agamemnon, going on a monologue about how he won't fight because Agamemnon took his girl, right? He loved Briseis. And we can interpret this part of Book 9 in Homer's Iliad through Book 10 of Ovid's Metamorphoses, with Orpheus once again being Achilles and Eurydice as Briseis. So here, let's read Book 10 of Ovid's Metamorphoses, lines 1 through 85. Orpheus and Eurydice. Hymen, called by the voice of Orpheus, departed and, dressed in his saffron robes, made his way through the vast skies to the Chaconian coast, but in vain. He was present at Orpheus's marriage, true, but he did not speak the usual words, display a joyful expression, or bring good luck. The torch, too, that he held sputtered continually with tear-provoking fumes, and no amount of shaking contrived to light it properly. The result was worse than any omens. Odysseus, the lead emissary for Agamemnon in Book 9 of the Iliad, we can interpret as the character Hymen, who is the Greek god associated with marriage and weddings. And like Hymen, Odysseus in Book 9 is not happy and he's nervous to approach Achilles because the Greeks are in dire straits without their best warrior. And Hymen is like the priest at a wedding, or like, so if there's like trouble with the band or the priest isn't showing up, it's a bad omen, right, for the wedding, resembling both Odysseus bringing offerings of Agamemnon's daughters in marriage, as well as Hymen in the story of Orpheus and Eurydice. Also, the line about Hymen making his way to the Chaconian coast, which is interesting in that if we understand Odysseus and Hymen as analogous characters, in Book 9 of Homer's Odyssey, it's Odysseus who fights the Chaconians off their coast, right? And he's forced back after being outnumbered, only after taking the priest of Apollo, Merone, the grandson of Bacchus, with him. So reading further from Ovid's Metamorphoses, while the newly wedded bride Eurydice was walking through the grass with a crowd of naiads as her companions, she was killed by a bite on her ankle from a snake sheltering there. When Thracian Orpheus, the poet of Rhodope, had mourned for her greatly in the upper world, he dared to go down to Styx through the gates of Tanaros, also to see if he might not move the dead. So a snake bites Orpheus's bride as she is walking in the grass about to be married off to Orpheus. And once again, Eurydice is Briseis, so the snake would be Agamemnon, this chthonic Semitic character that has abducted Eurydice and taken her to Hades, right? He's a Pluto-like character because Eurydice dies from the bite, and thus she ends up in Hades like Persephone. So thus we can say Briseis taken to Agamemnon's tent is similar, where the tent can be thought of this like as this dungeonous chthonic symbol like Tartarus or Hades. So reading further into Ovid's Metamorphoses, through the weightless throng and the ghost that had received proper burial, he came to Persephone and the Lord of the Shadows, he who rules the joyless kingdom. Then, striking the lyre strings to accompany his words, he sang, O gods of this world, placed below the earth to which all who are created mortal descend, if you allow me, and it is lawful to set aside the fictions of idle tongues and speak the truth, I have not come here to see dark Tartarus, nor to bind Cerberus, Medusa's child, with his three necks and snaky hair. My wife is the cause of my journey. A viper she trod on diffused its venom into her body and robbed her of her best years. I long to be able to accept it, and I do not say have not tried. Love one. He is a god well known in the world above, though I do not know if that is so here, though I imagine him to be here as well, and if the story of that rape in ancient times is not a lie, you also were wedded by a Moor. I beg you by these fearful places, by this immense abyss, in the silence of your vast realms, reverse Eurydice's swift death. All things are destined to be yours, and though we delay a while sooner or later, we hasten home. Here we are all bound. This is our final abode, and you hold the longest reign over the human race. Eurydice, too, will be yours to command, when she has lived out her fair span of years to maturity. I ask this benefit as a gift, but if the fates refuse my wife this kindness, I am determined not to return. You can delight in both our deaths. The bloodless spirits wept as he spoke, accompanying his words with the music. Tantalus did not reach for his ever-retreating water. Ixixion's wheel stilled. The vultures did not pluck at Tydeus's liver. The Belides, the daughter of Danaus, left their water jars. And you, Sisyphus, perched there on your rock. Then they say for the first time, the faces of the Furies were wet with tears, won over by his song. The king of the deep and his royal bride could not bear to refuse his prayer and call for Eurydice. She was among the recent ghosts and walked haltingly from her wound. The poet of Rhodope received her and at the same time accepted this condition, that he must not turn his eyes behind him until he emerged from the Vale of Avernus, or the gift would be null and void. This part of the tale of Orpheus is like that of Abraham in Genesis, right? Like Lot and his wife, when they're fleeing the destruction of Sodom and Gomorrah, where Lot's wife is turned into a salt pillar because she turned around and looked at the destruction of the city. But in the Orphic tradition, it's Orpheus who turns around and causes his wife Eurydice to vanish back into the depths of Hades because he peers back, right? He wasn't supposed to look back. So let's read further. They took the upward path through the still silence, deep and dark, shadowy with dense fog, drawing near to the threshold of the upper world. Afraid was she no longer there, and eager to see her, the lover turned his eyes. In an instant she dropped back, and he, unhappy man, stretching out his arms to hold her and be held, clutched at nothing but the receding air. Dying a second time now, there was no complaint to her husband. What then could she complain of, except that she had been loved? She spoke to her at last farewell that now scarcely reached her ears, and turned again towards that same place. Stunned by the double loss of his wife, Orpheus was like that coward who saw Cerberus, the three-headed dog chained by the central neck, in whose fear vanished with his nature, a stone transformed by his body, or like Eleanos and you, his, Lethea, too proud of your beauty, he wished to be charged with your crime, and seemed guilty himself. Once wedded hearts, you are now rocks sent on moist Mount Ida. Orpheus wished and prayed in vain to cross the Styx again, but the fair men fended him off. Still, for 7 days he sat there by the shore, neglecting himself and not taking nourishment. Sorrow, trouble, thought, and tears were his food. He took himself to lofty Mount Rhodope, and Haemus, swept by the winds, complaining that the gods of Erebus were cruel. So, like Achilles, Orpheus flees, right? He's crossing this body of water, the Styx, and he wants to go back home. Three times the sun had ended the year in watery Pisces, and Orpheus had abstained from the love of women, either because things ended badly for him or because he had sworn to do so. Yet many felt the desire to be joined with the poet, and many grieved at rejection. Indeed, he was the first of the Thracian people to transfer his love to young boys and enjoy their brief springtime and early flowering, the side of manhood. And reading from Book 9 of the Iliad, we have the passage that I interpret as analogous to this Orphic tale of Eurydice, right? This Book 10 of Metamorphoses, the first 85 lines. So from the Iliad, Book 9. They went their way by the shore of the surrounding sea and prayed earnestly to earth-circling Neptune that the high spirit of the son of Achaeus might incline favorably towards them. When they reached the ships and tents of the Myrmidons, they found Achilles playing on a lyre, fair of cunning workmanship, and its crossbar was of silver. It was part of the spoils which he had taken when he sacked the city of Aethon, and when he was now diverting himself with it, and singing the Feast of the Heroes. He was alone with Patroclus, who sat opposite to him, and said nothing, waiting till he should cease singing. Odysseus and Ajax now came in, and Odysseus leading the way, and stood before him. Achilles sprang from his seat, and with the lyre still in his hands, and Patroclus, when he saw the strangers, rose also. Achilles then greeted them, saying, "All hail and welcome. You must come upon some great matter, you, for who... All hail and welcome. You must come upon some great matter, you, for all my anger are still dearest to me of the Achaeans. So, like Orpheus, Achilles is playing on the lyre and singing of tales of heroes when Odysseus comes with an offer of an alliance from Agamemnon. And Orpheus, of course, was a singer and a poet who was associated with the cult of Apollo. And some aspects, he was like the opposite of the Eleusinian cult, or the Dionysian cult, and that I interpret his stories as a warning of what happens, kind of, to the Apollonian cult, and in a way of revealing the Eleusinian mysteries, translated through the characters of Adonis, Venus, and others, along with Homer's myth of Achilles and Agamemnon. The main takeaway, in my opinion, from Orpheus is that the importance of remembering the worshipping the female deities like Persephone, Venus, Diana, and Demeter. In other words, the birth rate of our people needs to be inspired and controlled through our religion, like all other functions of our society. Imagine Orpheus as singing a song about a woman he lost and can't get back, right? It's like a Bronze Age or Classical Age rock star, but more wholesome than, say, a Dionysian cult production. So let's read further from Book 9 in Homer's version of Orpheus is singing the tale of him and Eurydice. Achilles answered Odysseus, "Noble son of Laertes, I should give you formal notice plainly in all fixity of purpose that there are no more of this cajoling. From whatever quarter it may come, him do I hate even as the gates of hell, who says one thing while he hides another in his heart. Therefore I will say what I mean. I will be appeased neither by Agamemnon, son of Atreus, nor by any of the Danaans, for I see that I have no thanks for all my fighting. He that fights fair no better than he that does not. Coward and hero are held in equal honor, and death deals like measure to him who works and him who is idle. I have taken nothing by all my hardships, with my life ever in my hand, as a bird when she has found a morsel takes it to her nestlings, and herself fares hardly. Even so a man long night have I been wakeful, and many a bloody battle have I waged by day against those who were fighting for their women. With my ships I have taken 12 cities, and 11 round about 12 have Troy have I stormed with my men by land. I took great store of wealth from every one of them, but I gave all up to Agamemnon, son of Atreus. He stayed where he was by his ships, yet of what came to him he gave little and kept much himself. Nevertheless, he did distribute some meeds of honor among the chieftains and kings, and these have them still. From me alone of the Achaeans did he take the women, in whom I delighted. Let him keep her and sleep with her. Why, pray, must the Argives need fight the Trojans? What made the son of Atreus gather the host and bring them? Was it not for the sake of Helen? Are the sons of Atreus the only men in the world who love their wives? Any man of common right feeling will love and cherish her who is his own, as I this woman, with my whole heart. Though she was but a fruitling of my spear, Agamemnon has taken her from me. He has played me false. I know him. Let him tempt me no further, for he shall not move me. Let him look to you, Odysseus, and to the other princes to save his ships from burning. He has done much without me already. He has built the wall. He has dug a trench deep and wide all around it. He has planted within it the stakes. But even so, he stays not the murderous might of Hector. So long as I fought the Achaeans, Hector suffered not the battle range far from the city walls. He would come to the Scaean gates and to the oak tree, but no further. Once he stayed to meet me, and hardly did he escape my onset. Now, however, since I am no mood to fight him, I will tomorrow offer sacrifice to Jove and to all the gods. I will draw my ships into the water, and then victual them duly. Tomorrow morning, if you care to look, you will see my ships on the Hellespont, and my men rowing out to sea with might and main. If great Neptune vouchsafes me a fair passage, in 3 days I shall be at Phthia. I have much there that I left behind me when I came here to my sorrow, and I shall bring back still further store of gold, of red copper, of fair woman, and of iron, my share of the spoils that he have taken. But one prize he who gave has instantly taken away. Tell him, as I now bid you, and tell him in public, that the Achaeans may hate him and beware of him, should he think that he can yet dupe others, for his effrontery never fails him. As for me, hound that he is, he dares not look me in the face. I will take no counsel with him, and will undertake nothing in common with him. He has wronged me and deceived me enough. He shall not cozen me further. Let him go on his way, for Jove has robbed him of his reason. I loathe his presence, and for himself care not one straw. He may offer me 10 or even 20 times what he has not done. Nay, not though it all that be he has in the world. But now or ever shall be, he may promise me the wealth of Orchomenus, or of Egyptian Thebes, which is the richest city in the whole world, for it has 100 gates, through each of which 200 men may drive at once with their chariots and horses. He may offer me gifts at the sands of the sea, or the dust of the plain in multitude, but even so he shall not move me till I have been revenged in full for the bitter wrong he has done to me. I will not marry his daughter. She may be fair as Venus and skillful as Minerva, but I will have none of her. Let another take her, who may be a good match for her, and who rules a larger kingdom. If the gods spare me to return home, Peleus will find me a wife. There are Achaean women in Hellas and Phthia, daughters of kings that have cities under them. Of these I can take whom I will marry. Many a time I was minded, when I at home in Phthia, to woo and wed a woman, who would make me a suitable wife, and to enjoy the riches of my old father, Peleus. My life is more to me than all the wealth of Ilius, while it was yet at peace before the Achaeans went there, or than all the treasure that lies on the stone floor of Apollo's temple beneath the cliffs of Pytho. Cattle and sheep are to be had for herring, and a man can buy both tripods and horses if he wants them. But when his life has once left him, it can neither be bought nor harried back again. My mother, Thetis, tells me that there are two ways in which I may meet my end. If I stay here and fight, I shall not return alive, but my name will live forever, whereas if I go home, my name will die, but it will long ere death shall take me. To the rest of you, then, I say, go home, for you will not take Ilius. Jove has held his hand over her to protect her, and her people have taken heart. Go therefore as in duty bound, and tell the princes of the Achaeans in the message that I have sent them. Tell them to find some other plan for the saving of their ships and people, for so long as my displeasure lasts, the one that they have now hit upon may not be. As for Phoenix, let him sleep here, that he may sail with me in the morning, if so he will, but I will not take him by force. They all held their peace, dismayed at the sternness which he had denied them. So most people are probably more familiar with the story of the Trojan War, and more specifically the Iliad and Achilles, than say Orpheus. And the same with Exodus, where everyone knows who the Pharaoh and Moses are, but once again, many don't know who Orpheus is. Maybe that's kind of like how we're supposed to interpret Orpheus, is that he's ultimately doomed to this tragic fate, and his legacy is going to be obscured and perverted over time. And of course, we look to the myth for interpretation, right? We look to the text. So Orpheus was torn to shreds by members of the Dionysian cult for allegedly preaching about homosexuality and other more salacious allegations. But I can't help but look at these myths, but without a cynical view, right? Because one, calling someone a synonym for happy is, and has been for some time, used as a way to call someone lame, right, and feminine. And of course, that is an aversion itself, where it used to mean jovial, happy, and cheerful, right? And these are all synonyms for, like, good things. So it originally was a good thing. And not to say the cult of Apollo, or more specifically, the music industry, can't be subverted. For example, look at Michael Jackson. Is there like a more tragic figure in recent memory? The guy who at one point was like this wholesome person with talent, and he was corrupted, torn to shreds by this cult and mob of Bacchus, and his legacy perverted, whether true or not. But probably true. Probably true. I have sympathy for Mike, though, in that he, like everyone, has been cast into the fires of the Vulcan cult, unwittingly or not. And he made attempts, encoded, to speak out about it, right? But ultimately, his past was too checkered and it's too widely known that he became a very problematic and troubling figure where most people didn't want to associate with him, like, by the time he died. I still like the old stuff of Mike, though, right? When he was a brother, it was good music. And it's not just Mike. Today, you see everyone's torn to shreds by followers of the Dionysian cult and slandered as being a synonym of happy, and other more perverted and vile accusations. Anything where the tradition can be passed from older men to the younger men, right? Like, take any club or pastime, and it has to be slandered and torn to shreds by the Dionysian cults, right? It has to be subverted, and it leaves society barren, or at least keeps us from talking about these mysterious and specifics of these cults and cultic ceremonies to better, right, so we can better synthesize a way to counteract them, so we can go back to worshiping the daughters of Jove best, to have this better strategy to increase the fertility rate of our people. Sex needs to be one of, if not the most spiritual and important part of our cult. And Ovid or Orpheus knew this, right? Perhaps then maybe that's why they got some backlash, right? And another interesting similarity is Hymen, or Odysseus, as I interpret it. So before the Trojan War started, before the Iliad took place, Odysseus was charged with persuading Achilles to join the Greek side and to sail to Troy, united under the banner of King Agamemnon. And Achilles knew that Agamemnon would come asking for him. So his mother Thetis sent him away, and right, and he disguised himself as a woman to avoid detection. But Odysseus brought a bunch of weapons and other like cool war gear that guys like, and Achilles of course took interest, unlike the other girls that were around him. So thus he like revealed his identity, and Odysseus knew it was him, and he could drag him into the Trojan War. And Orpheus's death is similar in that I think there's some myths where he's hid among the nymphs or women followers of Dionysus, and when they bathe, he refused to take notice of them, and as not to right, he didn't want to become aroused, so he looked away. So they killed him for not paying attention to their naked bodies, right? Because he revealed himself to be a male and an imposter. Furthermore, there's a part from Apollodorus's Bibliotheca, where, this is the part where they're going over the history of Peleus, who is the father of Achilles. And there's a similar story to Achilles and Odysseus, where Peleus has his sword hidden in the middle of the night, and when he wakes up to look for it, his identity is discovered, and he's found by those tracking him. So, thinking of Achilles as Orpheus, he proves to be this tragic figure who's in love with a girl who stolen away by a Pluto-like figure of Agamemnon, and he becomes this tragic or hopeless romantic, which is the theme of many popular songs, right, by rock stars, and he ends up dying this horrible death, again, like rock stars. And of course, there are going to be all kinds of rumors that come out afterwards, and the myth grows each passing year. So, and also cults, of course, can be subverted, which I made a video on about the, you know, prismal scattering of Apollonian transmission, and Mark Brahman has written about it on his site, The Apollonian Transmission. And even today, we have examples of healthy and what should be wholesome communities and traditions that are slandered and perverted to disorient and keep boys from becoming men and carrying on tradition from their fathers, but also to confuse and entice people's minds to wander and forget about the most important part of our biologic function, which is reproducing. And that's what the cult of Venus, Persephone, Diana, Athena, etc. are for, so Demeter can produce a bountiful harvest. We need Venus to be ours again, and to be worshipped for her beauty in an idyllic standard or vision that will motivate good reproductive practices among our people. Right, and furthermore, Achilles obviously isn't a homosexual in that he loves Briseis, has multiple concubines that he's implied to have sex with during the Trojan War. And he also has two sons, right? He has kids, one Neoptolemus, who is fighting in the Trojan War not along with him, but he's in the war. He's obviously not gay, and some might even argue that he's like this castrated warrior, like a Janissary. But I argue he has undergone a circumcision ritual that essentially binds him in service to Agamemnon in the cult of Vulcan. He's taken part in this like Proto-Judaic or Christian ceremony that ropes him into servitude of the fire god. And if you go to chapter 12 of Exodus, it explains how circumcision will need to be done to non-Hebrew slaves as a way to get them to worship and serve Vulcan, or this mysterious fire god of Yahweh in the Hebrew Bible. It's as much a business plan and military strategy to enslave and motivate a population of males to slow the reproduction rate, but also to serve as a supply of the marshal to conquer new lands and treasures. And this induction, or identifying one as a member of the cult of Vulcan, or we can know better yet today as capitalism, or this like barbaric Bronze Age tradition of enslavement for the benefit and enrichment of a select upper class of plutocrats, it's this marking of the circumcision, right? If you fight for the U.S. Army, you fight for the dollar. You fight for Wall Street. You fight for the military-industrial complex. And you're probably circumcised, and you deal with the same conundrum that Achilles faces as serving a god who literally steals your soul and consumes your time and energy all for their benefit and your loss. Furthermore, like today in America, most males are circumcised without their consent, right? Sure, there are these high priest Enoch figures today, like transsexuals, they're becoming very popular in politics and other high-functioning positions. But I see Achilles as just this kind of, like, warrior. He's just circumcised. Because, like, how would you have sex or have kids without a penis? It doesn't make any sense. And, of course, people will reply with this suspiciously long paragraphs, like, the author really meant this was this weird sexual position, and when this happens and that, and this guy's really that, it's like, no, you've just thought about this way too much, and we really need to just understand it, that in order to reproduce, we need to have sex, and for that to happen, we need to have a mating call. We're animals, so we need this religion. And if someone's first inclination is to point out all these seemingly obvious sexual illusions, that then just today the more practical nuts and bolts of the ceremonies and pageantry involved with religion. It's like today, these online pseudo-religious types probably have no idea about the esoteric and symbolic meaning of a ceremony or any religious rites like a mass or baptism. But supposedly they know for sure that this and that are metaphors for homosexuality regarding Achilles and Apollo and every other stupid god or whatever. It doesn't matter. You have to wonder if they even attend church or interact with the clergy or understand that it's a real thing, right? That has scripture and theological text and ideals that they follow, and the priest and cardinals and all the members of the clergy and church need direction and instruction. How does the religion work? How to do religion? It's not so much as an elaborate metaphor for homosexuality or other loony conspiracies than a guidebook as a way to do the religion. How do you do religion? And of course, as you understand more the esoteric meaning, the more you can climb the ladder or ascend in the pyramid of a structure. And most systems, or at least well-functioning ones, work on this principle, right? You're not going to get the 11 herbs and spices your first day as a fry guy at KFC, nor access to the executive counts after your first day at Globotech Corporation. So all these reply guys, if anything, it's probably a good look into that person's thoughts and a measure of how entangled and debased that person's mind has become through propaganda and improper spiritual guidance and education.